You want to support Roller March Unfiltered? Be sure to join our Bring the Funk fan club. Every dollar that you give to us supports our daily digital show. There's only one daily digital show out here that keeps it black and keep it real. It's Roland Martin Unfiltered. Support the Roland Martin Unfiltered daily digital show by going to RolandMartinUnfiltered.com. You can make this possible.
The Black Caucus in Chicago wants to stop marijuana sales until this summer. Why? Because they want more opportunities for African Americans. Chairman Jason Ervin says there are no African American participants among the 11 existing dispensaries so far. The question is, who is going to get the first shot at the market during the first year of legalization? Caucus members voiced their concerns, which allows existing dispensaries to sell recreational marijuana beginning January 1st and to open a second location, saying it did not go and do enough to lift up communities most harmed by the war on drugs. Melick, has been an issue that I have raised. We saw this in Maryland. We've seen this by the Black Caucus in New York, where African-Americans are saying that the people who have been most impacted by communities ravaged, by people going to prison because of marijuana, African-Americans, should be first in line when it comes to getting these licenses. But what we're seeing is that's not the case.
And so I think that this is definitely not isolated to Chicago. This is definitely a national thing. If you look at the jurisdictions, the states that have actually legalized marijuana, whether that's Colorado or Vegas or California, Maryland, and even here in the district, the conversation is, we've always had these conversations about what type of benefits will, especially as far as licensing, will that be equity for blacks, if you will? Some places do it a little better than others. I think D.C. probably does it a little better than others because we do have a couple of black-owned dispensaries here in the district. But as far as a nationwide thing, I don't know if I necessarily, even though I support blacks getting licenses and things like that, I don't know if I really understand the argument as far as linking communities that have been impacted by, I guess, marijuana, criminalization of marijuana laws. I don't know if I understand the argument that the city of Chicago, or some of the people in Chicago, are making about how communities that have been impacted by people who've been impacted like ours, people who've been impacted by the marijuana laws. I don't know if I necessarily understand what they mean when they say equity from that point of view. I support dispensaries, but I don't necessarily understand what they mean when they say communities impacted by these marijuana laws.
Teresa is not real hard to understand. African Americans, significant number of people still sitting in prison for selling marijuana, and you have whites in America who are reaping the financial benefit of marijuana now being legal. It ain't that hard.
It isn't hard. And actually, here in Pennsylvania, it's two parts that's a disgrace. One is how the licenses were given out here. I think there was probably one African-American firm out of 30 that was issued licenses. And then two, we still have, especially in PA, so many prisons and counties across the Commonwealth that still have those who are in prisons for marijuana have not been released yet. And so what they say is it goes by county to county issue. So, yes, this is a huge portion of mass incarceration and criminal justice reform. But it's so interesting to see when this is happening to black and brown people that, again, the white people are now capitalizing. They're capitalizing again when we're in prison and they're getting a check. And then they're getting a check for legalizing it. And the people who were... It's so interesting. I can go through this whole thing, but it's really astonishing.
I don't understand why. You know, look, Kelly, if you've had communities that have been adversely impacted by when marijuana was illegal, why not say those folks should be first in line for dispensary?
I mean, that should be the solution, right? Not only should that, I think it should be a couple layers to this solution. Not only should the communities impacted by, you know, the war on drugs and criminalization of marijuana, not only should they be first in line for these licenses, but the convictions of those who are imprisoned because of said legislation and laws, retroactively should be expunged. So I feel like that would be true justice in that situation, because it makes no sense for you to have this decriminalization of a contraband and the people who are in jail for that same contraband, even though it's no longer illegal, they're still in jail for it. And frankly, they shouldn't have been in jail for that in the first place because of, you know, a slew of other issues. So the fact that Chicago has this problem isn't surprising to me, because it's across the United States for the cities who are in the process of decriminalizing marijuana. But at the same time, a part of the solution to the dispensary licensing as well should be retroactively expunging, and in the process of expunging, rather, the convictions of those in jail for the exact same action that people are profiting off of.
Yeah, I think Kelly raises a good point, but I think we're also conflating what's happening around the country, and it's really happening, the decriminalization of marijuana. That's one thing, but if we're talking about licensing for dispensaries, that's a totally different thing. And I'm more so of a proponent of, let's make sure that people, you know, black people actually get these licenses, rather than black people who live on whether people who live in Southeast DC or the south side of Chicago have access to these licenses. There are places, I want black people to be able to get these licenses in white neighborhoods. So it's not just in black neighborhoods.
Kelly, go ahead.
Roland and I are about to say the same thing. It's not necessarily about black people in certain neighborhoods getting these licenses, but they should be prioritized, because the criminalization of marijuana started in those communities. So what is the best way to rectify the impact of that, you know, frankly racist type of criminalization? The best way immediately to try and rectify that is to make sure that those communities have first dibs on those licenses. Not saying that they must get a license for that community, but the opportunity should present itself to those communities first, so that they can try and rebuild what was broken by way of the criminalization of something that should have been criminalized in the first place.
But are we talking marijuana licensing just black people in general, or communities that have been affected by it? So, for instance, the South Side of Chicago, certain parts of New York City, certain parts of, you know, Washington, D.C. Are we talking about that? Like people in Ward 8, Ward 7 and 8, D.C.?
Well, it just so happens those are predominantly black neighborhoods.
Right.
I don't think that you can just say, hey, you black person, only you can have priority over this license. I mean, I'm pretty sure there are laws on the books to say that segregation and, you know, racial discrimination in that regard is wrong. But the principle still stands that the, like you said, Ward 8, South Side of Chicago, Baltimore, what have you. These are predominantly black areas in major metropolitan areas. So if you say, hey, this area gets first dibs, what's going to happen? Likely, very likely, that black people are going to get those first. And that is what the opponents of said solution are afraid of.
Body washes, you.
Do you not, Mella, do you not see what the issue is?
Well, and again, that's why I said I think we're conflating, or maybe I'm just totally misunderstanding.
I think you're totally missing it. I think what we're saying is that if you have, look, it's not hard. This is not hard at all. And that is, what group of people has been most impacted by marijuana law? Black people.
Mm-hmm.
What we're saying is that now that marijuana is becoming legal in these states, worldwide, it's a $340 billion industry. Mm-hmm. Who should be first in line to benefit economically from the legalization of marijuana, when the people who were first in line for the war on drugs, communities that were ravaged and attacked, black people?
Okay. Now, if that's the argument, then no, I don't agree with that. Overall, I agree with setting aside whatever type of point system or something to benefit minority black and brown communities. I absolutely support that. And as I said, there are cities around the country that have been focusing on that, particularly Washington, D.C. And I think that's why, and Ward 8 in the ward that I live, I think that's why we have a black-owned dispensary in Ward 8 now. So I totally support the notion of Ward 8. But this notion that somehow communities, you know, because black people have been impacted most, then that's why we should get, you know, first dibs on licensing, I kind of push back on that. I don't see that as the reason why we should, because our communities have been impacted. I'm talking about an equity argument. We should be at the table, period, whether we were impacted or not. This is a business.
Yes, but the equity argument is that of anybody who is most impacted by marijuana laws has been black people.
Yeah, but I don't agree with the impacted
argument. Teresa, you get this, right?
I absolutely get it. And Mel, it's a bit interesting to hear that point of view. I'm totally agreeing with you that, you know, we should all be at the table. But again, since we were the ones that's still, you know, elected officials, Republican elected officials, white ones at that, are still getting their piece of the pie first, and probably in their district, because I said probably because I don't know if it's actually true, but they probably have individuals and constituents in their district who are probably still in prison right now because of a marijuana charge.
Right.
So for me, if that person comes out of prison after serving a time for a marijuana charge, you would think an apology happens and also a lead to the front of the line to now get some equity back on that if their plan is developed properly.
Now that part I don't agree with, because people were locked up, then those people who were locked up or who were affected by marijuana laws should get first.
Locked up for the charge.
Yeah, but even
about the charge.
Right, but being locked up for a charge, that should not give you first dibs on marijuana licensing, because at the time that you were incarcerated, marijuana was illegal. You know, depending on where you were, marijuana was actually illegal.
But that's the whole basis of our point. And the point is, because you stole lives and stole years of my life, so it could be from 5 to 10 when it was illegal, now that there has been an epiphany that it is legal, there should be some sort of compensation, really, and some more equitable reasoning. That's the only way you fix the solution, and that's the only way you come back to the table saying, okay, you know what? We're sorry. Here's the compensation. Now go ahead and grow since we stole your year.
All right, folks, back to that Roland Unfiltered video in just one moment. All right, folks, as the marijuana momentum continues, our friends at marijuanastock.org have already reached more than half of their funding goal for the hemp CBD investment. That's right. If you want to take advantage of this great opportunity, you need to do it now because it won't last much longer. If you don't know, I'm talking about the hemp plant, the good cousin to marijuana with a much higher concentration of CBD. That means hemp gives you all the medical benefits of marijuana without getting you high. Now, if you don't know, hemp farming is now legal in the United States, creating one of the largest commodities worldwide. It is an investment opportunity, and that's where the folks at 420 Real Estate come in. Their business model is simple. They buy land that supports hemp CBD grow operations and lease it to licensed high-paying tenants. That's right. They are hemp CBD landlords. You can get in on the action. As hemp continues to change the economic landscape, 420 Real Estate is allowing you to chase the American dream. The best part, you can invest in this crowdfunding campaign for as little as $200. That's right, $200 up to $10,000. Now, you must do it now before the fund is closed. To invest, go to marijuanastock.org. That's marijuanastock.org. Get in the game and get in the game now. Back to your Roland Martin Unfiltered video. We'll be right back.